Welcome to NCWIC Conversations for Change, an online thought leadership series. My name is Dr. Jeffrey Ann Wilder, and I work as a senior research scientist and director of strategic initiatives for women and girls of color here at NCWIC. It is my pleasure to welcome you to this series, which features speakers with a diverse range of opinions and hopefully provocative ideas and worldviews. Dr. Ivory Toldson noted that diversity in tech is a modern civil rights issue. Undoubtedly, since the racial reckoning of 2020, since the murder of George Floyd and many others, discussions about advancing racial equity have been front and center of national and global conversations and action. That is certainly the case across the computing ecosystem. I very much look forward to being able to bring us into conversation today about how we truly advance racial equity in tech. But before we kick off today's conversation, I want to recognize and thank our many NCWIC sponsors and collaborators who are making today's event possible. I also want to thank you, our viewing audience, in advance for your attendance and patience should we experience any bandwidth or other technical issues. During the talk today, I encourage you to post your thoughts, questions, and comments on the Q&A board as we go, using the Zoom icon at the bottom of your screen. We will be monitoring this and try to get to as many of those questions and comments as we can. And please, of course, complete our short survey at the end of our webinar. So at this time, I'd like to introduce our esteemed panelists, Dr. Toldson and Dr. Scott. Dr. Ivory A. Toldson is the National Director of Education, Innovation, and Research for the NAACP, Professor of Counseling Psychology at Howard University, and Editor-in-Chief of the Journal of Negro Education. Previously, Dr. Toldson was appointed by President Barack Obama to devise national strategies to sustain and expand federal support to HBCUs as the Executive Director of the White House Initiatives on Historically Black Colleges and Universities. He also served as president and CEO of the QEM Network and contributing education editor for The Root, where he debunked some of the most pervasive myths about African Americans in his Show Me the Numbers column. Dr. Toldson is also the executive director of the Journal of Policy Analysis and Research, which is published by the Congressional Black Caucus Foundation. He is also the author of Brill bestseller, No BS or Bad Stats, Black people need people who believe in Black people enough not to believe every bad thing they hear about Black people. Dr. Toldson is ranked among the nation's top education professors as a member of Education Week's EduScholar Public Influence Rankings, which is an annual list recognizing university-based scholars across our nation who are champions in shaping educational practice and policy. Welcome, Dr. Toldson.
Yeah.
Dr. Allison Scott is the CEO of the Kapor Foundation, which focuses at the intersection of racial justice and technology and works to remove barriers in access and opportunity such that the promise and potential of technology can be harnessed to create a more equitable future. At the foundation, Dr. Scott leads a team which works to expand equity in K-12 computer science education, expand diversity within tech companies and venture capital firms, and advance key policies to transform the technology ecosystem. Dr. Scott is currently a principal investigator of multiple national grants to expand equity in computer science education. And in her previous role as a chief research officer, authored foundational research on disparities in tech and equity in CS education and interventions to improve STEM education outcomes for students of color. Previous positions included Chief Research Officer at the Kapor Center, Program Leader for the National Institutes of Health, Enhancing the Diversity of the Biomedical Workforce Initiative, Director of Research and Evaluation for the Level the Playing Field Institute, and Data Analysis for the Education Trust West. Dr. Scott holds a PhD in Education from the University of California, Berkeley, and a Bachelor's Degree in Psychology from Hampton University. Wow, those are such huge, huge, huge bios. And it took me, I'm glad I was able to get through them both. So Allison, Ivory, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you.
All right, so let's get started. As you know, we recently closed out Black History Month and we're now at the beginning of Women's History Month. And in that spirit, I think it makes perfect sense for us to start today's conversation by sharing your stories and engaging with our ancestors. So if we could kick it off, if you all could tell us who inspired you to be who you are today, who struggled or sacrificed or encouraged for you to reach your full potential, and who you would like to thank for your current successes. We'll start with Dr. Scott. I know that's a mouthful, but just tell us a little bit more about your story and who inspires you.
Awesome. Thanks so much for the invitation to be here with you today, and I'm happy to join the panel with my good friend, Dr. Toldson, as well. So whenever I'm asked to like reflect on my journey, I often think about so many people that have had an influence on me and my life, and even people that have had an influence on my life before I came here. So I come from a family of educators. My background is in education. I became passionate about this work because of my parents and my grandfather, who were all in education, and taught me many lessons about the value of education. The importance of thinking about disparities, that not all folks have the same equal access to education. And they were real passionate advocates for justice in all realms. And in terms of my family, they also taught me a lot about my own family's history. This is a regular topic of conversation, and the sacrifices that they made that drive me both professionally and personally to fight for racial equity. My grandparents on my father's side were part of the Great Migration West from Louisiana out to Seattle, Washington. My grandfather on my mother's side was injured in World War II, so made a significant sacrifice on behalf of this country. And then along my educational journey, it's really hard to point to one person or even a couple people that have influenced me, but while I was at Hampton University, I had an amazing mentor, Dr. Reginald Jones, who inspired me to pursue a PhD. I had no idea what a PhD was, did not know anybody with a PhD. And he said, I think you should look into this, and then help to create a pathway for me forward. And I had an amazing mentor at Berkeley, Dr. Jabari Mahiri, who also ensured that I was able to complete my degree and was incredibly supportive along the way. And then Black women colleagues that I've had across many organizations who have created these like informal support networks of support and mentorship. And then finally, Mitch and Frida Kapor at my current organization, who really center racial equity. They walk the walk, talk the talk, and have supported me for over a decade. So I'd like to thank all of the folks that I just mentioned.
Amazing. Okay, Dr. Toldson.
All right. Thank you so much for having us. And I count Allison as a friend, a longtime friend, but I learned so much about you just in these first few minutes. But I'd like to share a little bit about my lineage. So on a plantation in Kentucky, probably about 20 years before the Civil War, there was a slave owner who sexually assaulted his a African woman that he claimed as his property, and had a son named Grandison Khan. That slave owner relocated from Kentucky to northern Louisiana, took Grandison Khan with him, not as his son, but as his property. And he started to have his own children once he relocated to his new location. His biological children went to school, but it was illegal for Grandison to attend school. But his biological half-siblings came back and taught him everything that they learned in school. So near the beginning of the Civil War, Grandison Khan gained his freedom. He went up north and enlisted in the Union Army and became a Civil War veteran. Returned to his state of Louisiana, had a daughter who had a son. The son was my grandfather, John Henry Scott, who was the president of the NAACP during the time in Louisiana, during the time when the NAACP was illegal. He had a daughter who was a civil rights activist in her own right. My mother, Janita Scott Obadeli, who led a reparations movement in the 1990s, and here I am today. And I want to thank my aunt, Cleo Scott Brown, who did all of the research so that I know my history, because it is empowering. I've only had this level of detail for only the last maybe 3 years of my life, but knowing that I have two great-great-great-grandfathers who fought in the Civil War on the right side of history is something that other children need to know about themselves. So I've had lots of inspirations throughout my school and education, too many to list, and I've already taken enough time, but we'll talk about that throughout the event. But thank you for allowing us to share our stories.
Thank you for sharing that. I think that is so important and kind of really sort of, makes a lot of sense around the paths that you both walk today. I think that is so important. As you mentioned, Dr. Toldson, for folks of African descent to really know their story going back several generations, there are a lot of us who don't have that ability or that good fortune. And it also lets us know, who we are capable of becoming, right? It makes perfect sense to see how and why you all are doing the work that you do. So with that, if you all could share a little bit more about the organizations that you are a part of. I know that you both are involved in so many things, but Dr. Scott, if you could tell us a little bit more about the Kapor Center and the work that you do, and then Dr. Toldson.
Absolutely, happy to share. And Dr. Toldson, after this webinar, I'm going to have to compare notes with you to see if we have some family connections down in Louisiana.
Louisiana, right.
So the Kapor Center, Dr. Wilder mentioned, the Kapor Center focuses at the intersection of racial justice and technology, working to hopefully make the tech ecosystem more diverse, inclusive, and impactful for communities of color. And we're really driven by the notion that we believe technology holds great promise and potential to close longstanding inequality. But its potential can only be realized when the creators of technology, the entrepreneurs, the investors, and the leaders of these companies actually reflect the diversity of the United States. And as we'll talk a little bit more about the report that we released last year, we have a long way to go in closing these racial equity gaps. At the foundation specifically, we operate STEM education programs for high school students of color. We work significantly in the CS education space. We recently published a framework on culturally responsive computer science education. So we're working to change the way that we think about curriculum, professional development, teacher training, and how to actually close racial equity gaps in computer science education through those mechanisms. We also produce research on the tech landscape. And then on the foundation side, we support organizations and initiatives that are advancing equity in computer science, in pathways to tech jobs and the tech workforce, and also investing in seed stage entrepreneurs that are designing products to close gaps of access and opportunity. Just a few more points. So last year we published research in collaboration with NAACP and Dr. Toldson on the Black tech ecosystem. We also published research on the CS teacher landscape and have been working to implement some of the practices from the culturally responsive computer science framework that I mentioned earlier. And then towards the end of the year, we launched an equitable tech policy initiative, which outlines 9 policy priorities that we believe will help to ensure the participation and protection of communities of color in tech.
Yeah, so I'm a professor at Howard University, the HU. All those in the audience, HU.
I can second. Hear you. Wait a second.
I've been at Howard since 2005 in the counseling psychology program, School of Education, and we're a majority graduate program. We have one undergraduate program in the entire college. But we mostly train master's and PhD level students for careers in education and in human development, including counseling psychology, school psychology, educational psychology, and things like that. I'm also the director of education, innovation, and research for the NAACP. I've been in this role for about a year and a half now. And this is a division of the strategy office. So we have a chief strategy officer, and we have several focus areas that are in our strategy office. Education is one of them. Some of the others is criminal justice, environmental justice, and health advocacy. But we all follow a 7-point advocacy model. One is mobilizing. So this is the events that we do where we bring people together, or we mobilize the community for a specific action to affect change. So this might come through protests, through rallies, through different campaigns. The second point is researching. So we have a research arm, and we conduct research to better understand different issues and also understand opportunities for change. Litigation is another strategy, and this is where we take legal action against bad actors, people who aren't working on behalf of civil rights, are working against civil rights. Storytelling, this is where we leverage the media to share stories about those who are most impacted by unjust policies. Convening, this is through our state and national convention and other types of conferences. And the final one is training. This is where we provide opportunities to our members to be trained on specific aspects of advocacy. And so this may be training related to helping them to reach out to members of Congress, or training related to use of data to advance civil rights. That's a specific training that I'll be conducting in New Orleans at the end of this month. So that's some of the work that we've been engaged in.
Wonderful. So, you know, I think over the past few years, there have been a lot of buzzwords that people use all the time. They really don't know what they really mean, right? So terms like diversity, equity, and inclusion have really, critical race theory, we'll talk more about that in a second, have been just thrown around, right? And people have sometimes really visceral reactions to them without really truly understanding what that means. When we talk about racial equity, what does that mean, right? So why is an explicit focus on racial equity so important, particularly when it comes to the tech ecosystem? And what do you feel is currently missing in that broader landscape of representation?
Would you like me to start?
And you know what, I realized that I didn't say who'd like to start, so feel free to jump on in.
Sure. I think it's a really important point about making sure that we have the right definitions as we're talking about the work that we're aiming to do, and articulating both our definitions and the frameworks that we're using as we're trying to identify solutions. So from my perspective, having an understanding of the definition of racial equity really means being grounded in definitions of racism that articulate both individual and systemic racism. And I feel like that trips people up a lot of times when we get to the discussion around systemic racism. So what I mean by that is that based on both current and historical policies and practices, that there have been systemic exclusion of Black, Latinx, and Indigenous folks from education, workforce, owning property, et cetera, in every realm and every aspect. And so I feel like starting with that definition is really important, and then moving from there to understanding where the current disparities have come from is such a critical piece. And I know we'll talk about that a little bit more as well. So what I think is missing is a shared framework for understanding why we are where we are. And then when we talk about disparities in the tech sector, we didn't just get to, you know, Google having, you know, 2% 2% of their workforce being Black by some accident. It didn't just happen this way, but there are a lot of systems and structures. And we talk about the leaky tech pipeline framework, which is one way to articulate from K-12 or even before K-12, all the way through post-secondary, the hiring processes in the tech workforce, all the way to the investors that are investing in the next companies. There are biases and barriers embedded throughout. So I think from my perspective, it's helpful to have a clear grounding and understanding of why disparities exist to be able to tackle some of the solutions.
Yeah, I agree. And this is a very important question in this time, you know, where so many challenges are happening under the guise of anti-CRT. And it's interesting that when they first started attacking critical race theory, they were making it seem like it was just about that particular theory. But we see them pivoting now to diversity, equity, and inclusion. And in fact, the one who started this whole thing, Christopher Rufo, a conservative strategist, he recently tweeted that it's time for them to do the pivot from CRT to DEI. So now they're coming after the core of what we've spent decades making mainstream and making, almost to the point where it's unacceptable not to have a good diversity, equity, and inclusion program. These are things that we really have to be on guard and to protect. And I think Allison, when she talked about people not getting the systemic part, I think she's spot on. The ones who are attacking this, they want to make it seem like it's about isolated cases of individual bad actors. But we've tried colorblind approaches in the past, and what we see is that colorblind approaches just don't work, and it's not just about individuals, it's something that's baked into the system. There was an article that I came across, and this was from 1970, because I was trying to see how long we've been talking about systemic racism on a systemic level. And in this article from 1970, they said white racism is fundamentally the assumption that being white is superior to being non-white. While few whites today would argue for a biological superiority, most whites assume a cultural, social, and personal superiority. White racism is woven into the fabric of American society and is used to justify the privilege of whites and the disadvantage of non-whites. A lot of people are positioning these arguments as something new, but 1970, it's been around, and this was a multiracial coalition of religious leaders who wrote this in the report. Things like ideas like white privilege, systemic racism, and some of the concepts that's associated with critical race theory are things that have been established through research and lived experiences for a half century or more. We have to understand it as something that is not up for debate, but something that's firmly established in who we are as a society. And something that we have to, that will probably take as long to correct as it took to bake it into the system.
My mom, who's 75 years old, always says, there's nothing new under the sun. Mm-hmm. And you guys are absolutely right. I think it's really important when we situate racial equity and why it's so important, right? We have to talk about, the socio-historical context connected to that, right? That, a lot of the things that we're seeing, particularly now, the backlash to, racial equity, DEI, all those things, it is not new, to your point, Dr. Toldson. You know what? I'm going to go ahead and skip some things on my agenda and move right to this question, to the next question, because we're kind of already going there. So let's talk about what's happening in the state of Florida and how organizations can respond. So if there's anyone who is a part of this audience who, right now is connecting Florida to Disney, and for some reason you haven't been a part of the news lately, let me kind of just get you up to speed really quickly. I think that we cannot get through one news cycle in 24 hours without hearing about something happening in the state of Florida. And we know that recently, or the past couple of years, in particular, the governor of Florida is starting to enact statewide policy aimed at ending not only DEI initiatives, and we saw that effectively end at New College of Florida just yesterday, but also claiming that the new AP African American Studies exam is non-educational, and attempting to defund a lot of DEI initiatives at the university level and also within K-12. We also know that there are some folks who are concerned because what is happening in Florida could be seen as a blueprint for what is going to happen in other states very soon, particularly states like South Carolina, Texas, and others. So given all of that, right, and we're not really here to, debate what's happening in Florida or to talk anything negatively about the governor per se, but the question is, how should organizations like Kapor Center and NAACP and NCWIT, national organizations, respond to these types of challenges? Is it a barrier or is it really just noise?
I would love Dr. Toldson to go first.
We're gonna toss it to you, Dr. Toldson.
Yeah, so, there's some dynamics in Florida that we really have to keep a close watch on. But I think that what we're seeing is a governor who's trying to position himself on a national stage and deliberately doing things that's going to give him national attention as opposed to local or state attention. He's pandering to Trump voters who may be looking for an alternative. And so the question always becomes from an advocacy standpoint, how much do we want to give him the attention that he's craving by responding to everything that he does? And that's always, you know, it's a touchy situation because he is doing some things that's causing a lot of harm. But he's doing it to get attention. And so one of the things, and when it comes to that 7-point advocacy, I think things like the lawsuits, you know, so the NAACP, we have been looking for potential plaintiffs in Florida who are harmed by these policies, students who don't have access, who won't have access to critical learning material, are maybe people who work at universities who are getting extra harassment scrutiny. So the litigation is going to be something that's very important. There needs to be a lot of grassroots organizing in Florida, because one of the reasons why he's able to do the things that he's doing is because of some of the wounds that the Democratic Party in Florida has. And, you know, we are a nonpartisan organization. But when you have this unchecked rhetoric, and so, you know, we're talking about a state that went for Obama twice, and then a governor who won his first race by only, you know, he won by maybe 10,000 votes. But since then, because of some of the things that happened within the Democratic Party and the leadership there, there's not a lot of opposition to him. So, you know, the coalition that Stacey Abrams was able to build in Georgia that effectively could, you know, have some counterbalance and to be able to fight some of the policies that the governor there might be trying to enact by supporting local, you know, down ballot races. We don't see as much of that in Florida. So I think a lot of that needs to happen. And so I think there needs to be some, you know, thesis of this. I think there needs to be a lot of more quiet campaigns to try to undermine the things that he's doing, and perhaps less loud, visible oppositions where you're going to get into a national debate with someone who's looking for that kind of attention.
Dr. Scott. So much to build on here. Great points by Dr. Toldson. So a slightly different direction and tangent, but I promise I'll connect the dots. So I had my own lived experience, obviously, as a Black woman, but it wasn't until I got to Berkeley and started studying like the decades of scholarship around the articulation of racial inequality in education. So all of the frameworks that are being discussed, CRT, culturally responsive computing, system, like understanding systems and definitions of racism. It wasn't until I had that grounding that it really helped me to understand, as I was saying earlier, how to articulate what the problems are and how to try to attack those problems with effective solutions. And so I say that to say, I think that's why it's so critical that all of us are learning this content. And of course that was in grad school. We're not talking about kindergartners learning critical race theory, but it was such a critical element of my own educational journey. And then we published the culturally responsive computer science framework. That was it was right around the time of George Floyd's murder. There was a lot of interest in thinking more deeply about how do we infuse culturally responsive concepts throughout computer science. One of the key tenets of that framework, the first key tenet, is to acknowledge racial inequality in education. That has now become a really a hot button issue, I guess. So that has become a contentious topic among, like, in teacher training and curriculum, and in states where aligned allies in education are also worried that they cannot use this framework with their teachers or in their schools because of potential implications, very real implications on their jobs, et cetera. So I think one of your questions was, like, what should organizations be doing? I think it's really important that organizations that are focused on equity and that have equity at the core don't back down from this fight. So I think there are many ways that we can continue to keep moving forward to understand what some of the legal constraints are, but to still articulate why we think these elements are so impactful and important for in our work. And then the last thing is something Ivory said about like grassroots campaigns and activism. And I think there's a lot that can be done just by parents and students and teachers, you know, standing up and saying what they think is important, what parents want their students to learn, what students want to learn, and what teachers feel like they should be teaching in their classrooms. And so I think there's a lot of potential on just the grassroots activism side. And let's not forget on the opposition side, that was an organized strategy around showing up to school board meetings and fighting against things like equity and culturally responsive education. So I think there's a lot that we can do on the other side as well.
Really, really important. Okay, so let's talk about how the two of you and your organizations join forces. So this year at NCWIT, we have been very intentional about cultivating and sustaining partnerships because we recognize how valuable a good partner can be, particularly when it comes to solving societal problems. So if you all could tell us, and you know, I think I'm gonna toss it to you first, Dr. Scott, tell us how you both decided to join forces to work on this report and to really work on and really kind of amplifying how important it is to advance racial equity in tech.
Yes, so we are incredibly grateful to have this partnership with the NAACP, and it's been cultivated over many years. I think just going back from our perspective, the role of the NAACP in the Black community, like, cannot be understated, right? The amount of progress that's been made through that organization's leadership and organizing and activism and legislation has been absolutely amazing. So we thought, like, you know, all along we've been approaching the partnership as there's no better organization serving the Black community that if they can also work with us on the tech side, that, you know, joining forces, we could be, you know, it could be very powerful. So just over the years have been things like, you know, sharing information, partnering on campaigns. We've also partnered on, like, from our organization, we're focused on diversity in tech and not necessarily on civic engagement and grassroots, like, get out the vote campaigns. However, we saw, like, if we want to actually make change in some of these critical areas around CS education, around holding tech companies accountable, like ensuring that Black folks are able to register to vote and turn out to vote is critical. So we've partnered on some political campaigns as well. And just we're super excited to partner on the report because I think it articulates the importance of having an organization focused on tech and an organization focused on civil rights and the Black community to partner together to say, these are the challenges that are currently facing the Black community as it relates to the tech workforce. And here is a set of solutions that we want to collectively advocate for. So we have been really excited to have that partnership.
Dr. Toldson, what does this partnership mean to you?
Yeah, so Kapor has really been the driving force behind the partnership. But even prior to me coming to the NAACP, I've had some intersections with the Kapor Center. We have a NSF grant that worked with HBCUs and STEM, and really looking at how HBCUs became such robust producers of STEM talent. And one of our PIs Cynthia Overton is someone who is working at the Kapor Center. I know she has an executive level role. I forget the exact title, but it was through there. I had a partnership with Kapor even before I got to the NAACP. I've been to the Kapor Center. They hosted a book signing for me there. The book that you mentioned with the long title, Black People Need People, Believe in Black People Enough Not to Believe Every Bad Thing They Hear About Black People. That's the title I had to practice at. So when I got to the NAACP and I learned that that the Kapor Center was writing this report, it was something that, you know, they didn't have to ask me twice to lead it on the NAACP side. And as I looked at the statistics that they generated and had conversations with Kapor about, you know, what does this mean for Black people? That's when, you know, it really hit me that, you know, this is a civil rights issue. This is a modern day civil rights issue. As, you know, many other things, as the workforce has evolved, the civil rights issues have evolved. And this is an issue that that has emerged and something that we really need to do something about now with urgency.
All right, well, we are moving right along in the conversation, and we have our Q&A is blowing up, and I wanna make sure that we're able to respond to some of the questions that our audience has. But before we do that, I have one other question I'd like to ask both of you, and it kind of sort of bookends the, you know, the opening question about your stories and who inspired you, and to think more about, you know, sometimes I have to look at, really like do a double take with a calendar. It's hard to believe that it's 2023, right? Because I still feel like I'm 20 years old, right? But let's go back 20 years, shall we, to 2003. I'm gonna assume that you all were in your 20s, right? Early 20s, mid 20s, something like that, right? You know, maybe 13, 14, right? You're 13, 14, right? What advice would you give your 20-something year old self? Start with you, Allison.
Okay, this is such a good question. I think professional advice I would give my 20-year-old self, and also like anything. Professional advice I have given to others has been to really just find your passion. So often I feel like you know, we're guided in a certain direction. So we have these messages in our heads about either making money or being successful, or, you know, that it might drive us off of a path that we actually want to be on. And so I would say, like, find your passion and let that drive you. Like, so often people come and say, like, can you give me advice about, like, should I get a PhD? And I'm always like, why do you want a PhD? What's the purpose? Is this like part of something that you greatly value, that you feel can help to accelerate, you know, the impact of the change that you want to have in the world? So I would say, like, find your passion and let that drive you, as opposed to any other consideration. And then personally, I would just say, like, time flies, as you said, Dr. Wilder. So like, enjoy it, like, take time to enjoy and look around and not always be like so driven on like a professional pathway that we don't take time to enjoy, like, you know, the beauty that surrounds us, or, in, you know, spend time traveling or spend time with your parents and family members. That's not always going to be there.
Yeah, a few things that stick out to me. Focus on what you want to do, not what you want to be. Too many people get hung up on titles. I want to be this, I want to be that. But you really do need to think about what you want to do. Because, you know, if you're doing what you love, it doesn't matter, you know, it doesn't matter, the title doesn't matter. Another thing I would say is to always appreciate where you are, you know, whatever station you are, whatever you know, if you're at Berkeley, if you're at Hampton, if you're at Howard, if you're at Southern University, represent that institution, and be a good steward of that institution, learn about that institution, and always work on behalf of an institution, not on behalf of a person. Work for an institution, not a person. So you may be giving directives from a person, but you need to understand how those directives fit in with the mission of that organization. And if you don't understand that, then there needs to be a conversation, and you need to do some level setting and perspective setting, because you really do need to, in order to produce for organization, you have to have that perspective. Last thing I'll say is, you know, there's two things that you can contribute to any organization that you're with. One is your thoughts, and the other is your labor. Your labor can always be replaced, but your thoughts can't. If you leave the organization, your labor stays there, at least the fruit of your labor stays there, but your thoughts go with you. And so you always want to position yourself in the organization to where you're not just providing labor, but you want to try to prime yourself when you're young to really think about how you can, how your thoughts can be the greatest contribution you're making to an organization.
Now, both of you are giving me some really good advice for 2023 that my 46-year-old self would love and will start to really take to heart. We have lots of questions in our Q&A. Also, to our audience members, if you want to ask questions or have comments, go ahead and drop those questions and comments in the Q&A right now. I'm going to start with the first question is for Allison. To Allison, so many amazing things. Is there any work that you or other groups do that target middle schools, specifically girls and students of color in 6th through 8th grades and or educators in the middle school?
Neha, thank you so much for the question. So there's some work that we're doing. I'll talk really briefly about that, but there's a lot of amazing organizations doing a lot of amazing work. So I have a colleague, Freedom McAleer, who's doing work with schools that specifically serve Indigenous students and working on developing curriculum in collaboration with teachers and with community members that is completely culturally aligned. And so that's some really interesting pilot work that's happening across a couple states. We also, through the framework that I mentioned earlier, we have partnerships with a bunch of organizations who are trying to implement the culturally responsive framework in their like teacher training. Some of whom are for middle schoolers, some of whom are for high schoolers. And there are just a ton of organizations like Girls Who Code, code.org, Hidden Genius Project is more focused on Black boys, but at the same age range. And I should also shout out Dr. Kimberly Scott, who has led CompuGirls at Arizona State University for many years. And I believe their programs are still going through the Center for Gender Equity in Science and Technology. Those are just a few examples, but thank you for the question.
All right, I have a question here specifically for Dr. Toldson. Dr. Toldson, you mentioned about a pivot from CRT to DEI at the highest leadership level, and we need to be on guard about that. Could you clarify what's the pivoting that's going on?
So the conservative think tanks that orchestrated this CRT hysteria, the ones that have created this kind of McCarthyism around CRT and made it the latest boogeyman, they have announced that they are pivoting from focusing on CRT to DEI. They like the way that this has landed. And strategically, I think they knew that targeting DEI from Jump Street wasn't the right move, because diversity, equity, and inclusion are things that sounds good. It resonates well, and everything that they've done, they've made public somewhat. But they did talk about how CRT sounds. You know, the critical part of it, race. Theory makes it seem academic and highbrow and someone talking down on you. And they wrote about this. Christopher Rufo wrote about the CRT strategy, but he has just announced that because of the success of CRT, he's ready to focus on and direct all of the minions around to pivot from CRT to dismantling DEI programs. So, you know, what's going to be our strategy? How are we going to protect diversity, equity, and inclusion, because they are coming for these programs next?
Okay, we're going to pivot a little bit. One audience member asked, do either of you have any advice for talent acquisition teams who want to tap into the underrepresented talent in the tech industry?
I really like responding to this question. So the first thing that's absolutely important is for the talent acquisition team to answer the question, answer questions, why do you want underrepresented talent? And what type of underrepresented talent do you want? And to be more specific about type, are you looking for underrepresented talent that have the same background, perspectives, persona, experiences as the well-represented talent that you already have? You know, so do you just want the Black person from what you consider the top institution? Are the Latina who has a profile that if you remove the name, you would think you were looking at a white person? Is that what you want? Are you looking for someone that can bring a completely different perspective to your organization? What are your organization's needs, and how do you think diversity will fit those needs? If you don't go through that exercise, your default position will be to take the type of talent that you already know, that you've already been baked, that's already been baked in your head, and try to find someone of color or some other underrepresented background that fits that mold. And that will do very little for your organization. It'll also limit your talent pool considerably. Because that will make you say, well, I haven't heard of HBCUs, so I'm not going to recruit from HBCUs, but I have heard of Berkeley and Stanford and these places, so I'm going to try to find that Black person at Stanford. And that's why that Black person at Stanford is getting all these offers, because everybody wants them, not because of their perspective, but because of their color. So we can't profile when it comes to that. And when you do that, you'll find that you greatly open up your talent pool because you really are looking for talent. You're looking for true, authentic, diverse talent, and that talent is out there.
If I could just add one thing, because I think that was absolutely perfect. The only thing I would add is to start with like an audit of the processes, right? So like if we think about talent acquisition from identification of, you know, job description to recruitment pools and strategy to the actual hiring process, to the interview process, to decision-making, like doing an audit of that and articulate, like trying to identify where there are specific biases baked in. So Dr. Toldson just mentioned one that like stands out a lot in hiring in tech, which is like going with pedigree as like a proxy for skill. So I know of this university that equates to like a high performing computer engineering major. That's not at all accurate or true, but that's like a bias that is baked into the process in many places. So I would say like just starting with an audit of the processes. And then I agree that it totally opens up the talent pool. And something else that we talk a lot about is like non-traditional pathways into tech jobs. So things like boot camps and apprenticeship programs and just different ways that folks can develop skills and demonstrate skills, but the employer has to be willing to hire folks that have come through a non-traditional pathway as well.
Okay, we are getting close on time. I think we have enough time to maybe get to two more questions. So this next question is for Allison. Allison, Dr. Scott, what's your perspective on the CSTA Equity Fellows' recent call to action? Can you really be an ally and advocate for historically excluded communities if you stand in direct opposition to the equitable treatment of people in those communities? Ooh, that's a good one.
I so appreciate that question. I have many thoughts, but I will be brief so we can get to the other questions as well. I greatly appreciate the CSTA Equity Fellows for calling attention to this issue. So what they were articulating was, how do we hold two things at the same time? If we say we're fighting for equity in computer science education, how can we actively fight against equity in other realms? And I think that is a question that the CS education community is now being forced to reckon with. And I think that is a good thing that we need to reckon with. We need to reckon with this. And what I would love for us to, what I would like to see is that we as a group articulate what we want the next 10 years of computer science education equity to look like, not computer science education broadly, not computer science for all that doesn't center equity and closing specifically racial equity gaps. So that's what I would love to see. Again, I'm just really thankful that the CSTA Equity Fellows called this out and articulated it and made such an important point.
Okay, and last question for Dr. Toldson. Following up on the comment about bringing your personal thoughts and experiences to an organization as a young professional, could you go a little more in depth about how you personally leverage that for yourself and how a young Black professional can do the same in the higher ed environment, in the higher ed government relations space to create an equitable system?
Okay, that's a good question. So the first thing you want to do is to represent your organization. I kind of talked about that before. But whatever whoever you're working for, wear the lapel, wear the sweatshirt on Dress Down Fridays, get the mug, and talk about the mission and where you see the organization going, how the organization could work on behalf of people that they may not be serving well. So you wanna have pride in the organization that's demonstrated and palatable, but you also want to talk about, share ideas about how to leverage the organization to do more. And people will listen to you more because they know that you're coming from a place of, I want to build the organization. I'm not tearing down the organization. So you can criticize someone better when they know that you love them. So you want to express your love for the organization, then you want to criticize them. And then you want to start thinking about what your moment is going to be. Typically, people's moment is when they bring a lot of people together. Some organizations lend themselves better to that than others. But if you can create an event for your organization, if you say, listen, this organization needs to hear from such and such. This organization needs to hear from Allison Scott. I heard her on this panel. So I'm going to reach out to Kapor, and I'm sorry for doing this to you, Allison. I don't want you to get a whole bunch of invites now, but you get the point. You want to try to create moments of the organization, and you can start with small moments, but you want that big moment too. You want that moment where there's impact. It's something that you're seeing as being a part of it, central to it. And something that really helps the organization to do the things that it's supposed to do. A lot of people aren't doing that, but when the organization has that person, they do not want to let them go, and they're often being poached by other organizations. And that goes to your second question, how did you leverage that for yourself personally? That's exactly what I've done throughout my career. I never go into an organization thinking what the next organization is going to be. I go into an organization thinking I'm going to retire from that organization and I have pride in that organization. And even if there's effed up people all around me, all I have to do is look at the mission of the organization. And I want to, there's changes that I want to make that's consistent with the mission. And that's what I'm fighting for that organization. So that's the advice I would give.
Very sage advice. Any final words from Dr. Scott or Dr. Toldson as we round out our conversation this afternoon, morning, afternoon? All right. Well, I'd like to thank everyone, particularly, our esteemed panelists for joining us today. We learned so much about not only your stories, but how we really can leverage our moment to advance racial equity in tech. I'd also like to thank you all in our audience. Thank you for joining us. And being a part of today's discussion. I'd also like to thank our sponsors. And of course, please do not forget to complete the survey, which is accessible on the QR code here on the slide or at the link that is going to be coming up here in the chat in a moment. We at NCWIT will follow up with an email with the links and the resources that Dr. Toldson and Dr. Scott shared. And please save the date for our in-person and virtual summit coming up May 18th and 19th in Denver if you want to hear more inspiring conversations like this one. Thank you so much for joining us today, and we wish you all a wonderful end of your week and an even better Women's History Month. Thanks for joining us.